Wake up.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Medford United Methodist Church. It's good to have you with us. My name is Joe Monahan. I'm the senior pastor here. And on behalf of our associate pastor, Rachel Callender, the staff, the congregation, we want to say thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for joining us if you're online as well. We are finishing up this week, today, our series that we've been doing for the past 4 weeks about the Bible. And many of you have said that this series has been very helpful for you. And so I'm really grateful for that. I'm glad that we found a way to approach this topic in a way that was helpful for you. And some of you have talked about sharing some of the things that you've learned with people that you know. And so I'm really grateful for that as well. If you haven't had a chance to listen to all these sermons, you can go back through and visit our YouTube channel. Check those out. But today, where we're headed, to kind of wrap this up, Rachel's going to be talking about how we read the Bible for all it's worth. In other words, how do we derive the most benefit for ourselves spiritually from this gift that God has given us in the Scriptures. So that's where we're headed today. If you're joining us in person today, we hope that you'll take a minute and share your name and contact information on the red pads that the ushers are coming around for. If you are online today, please, we hope that you'll take a minute, that you'll share the stream, and you can also check in with us. We've created a new website, a new landing page, and you can use that whether you're in person or whether you're online. It's medfordumc.org/Sunday, and there you'll find all the stuff that you need for the day, and whether that's a way to download the app or to make a gift or to get to announcements and review the announcements, things that we talk about here. So that's a really great tool that we've created, and in the next few weeks we're going to create a little QR code that'll be in the seat back pocket so that you can scan that and you'll be able to get right there. So we look forward to that. And so again, that's medfordumc.org/Sunday. So a couple of things that I want to lift up as our announcements this morning. So first, in conjunction with the Bible series that we're wrapping up, we have planned a couple of sessions to talk specifically about Scripture and how it relates to the inclusion of LGBTQ persons in the life of the church. That's a resource and an opportunity for learning that many of you had asked for. And so we're going to be doing a couple sessions on Zoom, and the first one is coming up on Tuesday night at 7:30. So we hope that you'll come to that. Again, the Zoom links are in the weekly email that we send out, but you can also get there at medfordumc.org/Sunday to get to that weekly email. Also, our church conference, which is our annual congregational meeting, that's coming up on this Thursday at 7:30. It'll be with our district superintendent, Hector Burgos, and we're looking forward to that. Also on Zoom, again, link at medfordumc.org/Sunday, and then if you look at the weekly email, you'll find it there. And don't forget to check out all the announcements. We are in the full swing of our Push or Tush annual move-a-thon event that raises money for scholarships here in the church. And so we would love to have you participate in the activities. We've got activities planned throughout the month. Also, for your individual contributions and your individual logging of minutes, you can do all of that at pushortush.medfordumc.org. And so really excited about that. I'm sure, too, that some of the representatives of the United Women of Faith, who are the sponsors of this event, will be out in the lobby as well after the service, so you can check out what's going on. I want to introduce to you Bethany Carl, who is our Director of Youth Ministries, and she's going to come and share a little bit about some things that she has going on and some opportunities for you to get involved.
Good morning, everyone. How are you?
Good morning.
Good. Well, I am so excited to be up here to share that we have started all of our children, youth, and family ministries. We have something for everyone from preschool all the way up through 12th grade. We have Bells that started on Thursday, and that meets from 5:30 to 7:15 with our music director, Barb Frame. So she's in the back there. Wave, Barb. So she would love to have any child 5th through 12th grade join Youth Bells, but is also interested in anyone younger than 5th grade who is interested in something musical. So you can email her in our newsletter. Her email is included there where the Youth Bells announcement is, and you can email her telling her your child younger than 5th grade is interested. After Youth Bells starting this week, we have Youth Group is back. I'm so excited that Youth Group is back. From right after Bells until about 7:15, we'll be in here hanging out, basketball, pickleball, puzzles, card games, whatever your kid, 6th through 12th grade, wants to do, we're going to do so we can hang out. I would love anybody who loves middle school and high school and wants to hang out with me with that age group to let me know you're interested. We also have our 9 a.m. Programs here in the worship. So our kids' church is pre-K, so 3-year-old through 5th grade. They're in the back there coloring, playing with toys right now. When the kids' moment is done, there'll be volunteers that take them upstairs to lead in a program that we already have created. And so you don't need to have teaching experience. If you would like to be on a rotational basis to help out with that programming. And we also have 6th through 8th graders at the back that I'm hanging out with to listen to the sermon and then go off and have a little bit of like a Sunday school style check-in about what they learned in worship. And so those are some ways on a weekly basis I would love for you to be a part of. You don't have to have a child in the program, people of all ages, if you're inspired, please reach out to me to let me know that you'd like to be a part of it. And also we have one special events, family events. Our one coming up right now is Trunk or Treat. So that is October 23rd from 3 to 5 in the afternoon. Families come out dressed up. We'd love that. Everybody please decorate your trunk so we can have fun Sunday afternoon. And pray for the good weather because that always helps. And so if you want to sign up for decorating a trunk, that is in our newsletter. And also there's sign-ups in the lobby as well. That's a lot. But I'm excited, and I hope that you'll all be a part of the fun of children, youth, and family ministries here at MUMC. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Bethany. And I hope that you will plug in. We want to be able to offer opportunities for our children, for our youth, for our families. But we need your help. We need volunteers. We need people to step in and step up and assist with some of these programs. So we're really grateful for your help in all of that. So if you want to connect more deeply, if you want to find out more about these announcements, again, medfordumc.org/Sunday. You can also find the weekly announcements in the app as well. Let's begin with a word of prayer as we enter into our time of worship. Let's pray together. Holy Lord, wash over this space this morning so that your holy name may be praised. Flow through our prayers, our singing, our silence, and meditations so that our worship of you may extend beyond just this time here together, but also in each and every day. Amen. All right, Nate, turn it over to you.
Good morning, everyone. It's so good to be with you today. I'm excited to worship together. I'm going to invite you to stand as you're comfortable and able. Let's lift our voice together.
King's and King's.
next verse.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, no, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the light. And I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. Come on. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love.
There's power.
So I'm wondering if there's some young people that would like to come and spend a couple minutes with me up here. Would you like to come? We'll talk for just a minute. And if you have some children at home that are with you and you want to have them gather around the screen wherever you're watching, come on, everybody. Good morning. How are you? Good morning. Hey, guys. How is everybody today? Good morning. Good morning. Wow, it's so great to see so many new faces. Good morning. Come on. How are you? Good. It's good to see you. Well, welcome, everyone. So we're talking today about a special book. I'm wondering if you have special books that you really like to read. Do you have special books that you like to read before bed? Yeah? What are some of your favorite books to read before bed? You like Harry Potter? Okay, great. Read all the Harry Potter books. That's good. Bailey, what's your special book that you like to read before bed?
Noodle.
Noodle? I don't know that one. So what's Noodle about?
No Bones Day.
Oh, No Bones Day. Yeah, I do know about No Bones Day, right? How about you, Brendan?
Pokemon Quest.
You like to read about Pokemon Quest? Okay, great. What's another book? How about you?
Minecraft the Island.
Yeah, it's okay.
Like that was in the middle of a big lake, and now it's like survival mode in Minecraft, and they like, and he survives. Like, he's trying to survive. Like, he built. So, I've only read the first 8 chapters.
I see. Oh, no, not the zombies. I can't stand the zombies. Survival mode is not that easy, is it?
Yeah.
You don't play in survival. Do you play in survival mode, or do you just build stuff?
Oh, I go create advanced survival. I build stuff and then just save it.
Wow. That's a lot. That's more than I can do. That's for sure. How about the rest of you? Other kinds of books that you like to read? Anything? Well, one of my favorite books when I was a kid. Does anybody read Dr. Seuss books?
Yeah.
Yeah, I really like Dr. Seuss books. My favorite was Green Eggs and Ham. That was my favorite book. And I also like Fox and Socks. That's one of my favorite books, right? So there are a lot of special books that we have that are really important to us. There's one special book that's really important when we come into church, and you already know what it is. You know what the answer is already, right, William?
Bible.
Right? So this is also a special book, right? This is my Bible that I use. And although a lot of times I read the Bible on my phone now, right? But in here are a lot of different kinds of stories that help us to understand what God has done in the world and how much God loves us, right? So in here we find the stories about how God created the world. Do you remember the story about Noah and the ark? Right? Do you remember that story? Right? About the big flood? Well, you'll have to find out about that story. So it's in here. It's in the book of Genesis, right? So you can ask your parents maybe to read that story. So there's a story about how Israel crossed through the Red Sea when Moses was leading them to freedom and how the seas parted, right? There's a story in here about David and Goliath. Is that familiar to you? David and Goliath, that story. There are stories about Jesus and how he healed people and how he fed 5,000 people with just a little bit of bread and a couple of fish, right? There are stories about how Jesus did all kinds of teaching and how much he loved people. And so when we read this book, this is the book that tells us how it is that God loves us and what it means for us to live the way that God wants us to live. So I hope that this might also become one of your favorite books. It's one of my favorite books. And so I hope that as you grow, that you'll learn more from this book, okay? And that's what we're here to do in the church, is to help you to learn more of the stories and more about life from this book, all right? Does that make sense? All right. Bailey, what would you like to say? About a couple of movies, maybe about Moses or about Noah or about Jesus.
Noah.
Yeah, you saw a movie about Noah?
Movie.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. Wonderful. Well, how about we do this? Can we pray together? So let's take a moment and we'll pray together, right? And put your hands together. And if you'd like to repeat after me, you know, say some words and you can repeat after me, okay? Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the Bible and all it has to teach us about how much you love us. Help us to keep learning more and more each day. Amen. All right, everybody. It was nice to see you. Thanks for coming to spend some time with me. Thanks for those of you who are online for spending time with us too. So we'll see you in just a little bit. Just watch my coffee as you walk back to the back, okay? All right, perfect.
Good morning.
The scripture reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 55, verses 1 through 11. All of you who are thirsty, come to the water. Whoever has money, come, buy food, eat. Without money, at no cost, buy wine and milk. Why spend money for what isn't food, and your earnings for what doesn't satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good. Enjoy the richest of feasts. Listen and come to me. Listen and you will live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful loyalty to David. Look, I made him a witness to the peoples, a prince and commander of peoples. Look, you will call a nation you don't know. A nation you don't know will run to you. Because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, who has glorified you. Seek the Lord when he still can be found. Call him while he is yet near. Let the wicked abandon their ways and the sinful their schemes. Let them return to the Lord so that he may have mercy on them, to our God, because he is generous with forgiveness. My plans aren't your plans, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. Just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my plans than your plans. Just as the rain and the snow come down from the sky and don't return there, without watering the earth, making it conceive and yield plants, and providing seeds to the sower and foods to the eater, so is my word that comes from my mouth. It does not return to me empty. Instead, it does what I want and accomplishes what I intend. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us come to God in prayer. Heavenly Lord, speak to us in new and exciting ways this morning. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, God, now and forever. Amen. Allow me to let you in on a preacher's nightmare. It might not be what you think. Preacher's nightmare, some worship is going on, sang some hymns, right? And the scripture reader comes up, and the scripture reader reads the scripture in such a beautiful and new and refreshing and different way that it is in that moment, 20 seconds before walking up to the pulpit, that you come up with a new idea, right? All of a sudden, I now have a new idea that is different and maybe even challenging to what I spent 15 hours that week writing, right? It happens more often than you think, but it's amazing how just hearing someone else's words can bring new life and new beauty to scripture. The Bible, the best-selling book of all time. In 1995, the Guinness World Records claimed that the Bible has sold over 5 billion copies worldwide. It's also, with great irony, the most stolen book in all of history. But is it the most read book? Probably not. According to a recent study in 2019, Americans who read their Bibles at all was at an all-time low of 48% until, interestingly enough, the pandemic hit. The difference between the percentage of Americans who never read their Bibles right before the COVID lockdown was 35%, and that dropped to 29% of people who never read their Bibles as of January 2021, meaning in a one-year time, 6% of people began reading their Bibles. And even amongst those who were already Bible readers, those who read the Bible most days during the week, that increased from 12% to 16% between 2020 and 2021. And that's to say that though most churches are still struggling with things like attendance since the beginning of the pandemic, people's desire to study God's word has not lessened. In fact, it's increased. A study in England and Wales from before COVID also found some interesting findings. They found that 45% of men and 59% of women could recall a Bible at least being somewhere in their home. Yet age played a big part of this. For those over the age of 65, That number increased to 69%, as opposed to those under the age of 44, which decreased to 39%. More than half did not know what version they had, 40% assuming they had a King James version, and only 21% of Bible owners have purchased a Bible, as most receive it as a gift, and then the rest inherit a Bible. I probably would totally mess up all those numbers, right? I'm under 44, I probably have like 30 Bibles, right? It comes with the job. Now see, what I love is getting a glimpse at someone's favorite Bible. And I'm not talking about the pretty untouched one that sits on your bookshelf. I'm talking about the one that looks a little rough, might have some tape on the binding, bookmarks sticking out of it, dog-eared pages, a coffee stain or two, we're not gonna tell, right? Scribbles or thoughts or maybe even prayers throughout the margins, and occasionally maybe a little sketch of a flower or a star. Those are my favorite Bibles. Those are the Bibles that I want. And for me, that is my study Bible, my HarperCollins study Bible. It's an NRSV. It has all the extra apocryphal texts that aren't in the canon. And my handwriting is all over it. You can easily flip through this and see which texts speak to me and which texts I struggle a lot with. But my favorite Bible is probably my third grade Bible, one I got back as a little kid. It's a lot better shape, but what's interesting is that if you flip to the back of it, you'll find all these diary-like notes that I wrote, dating all the way back to 2003. And even from that, from what must have been age 9, I guess, I was writing about opening my Bible for something, a desire for inspiration and guidance in God's voice. And what became evident in my looking over this 16 years worth of Bible notes of mine is the learning curve in developing tools to be able to do just that, to be better equipped for reading the Bible when I'm experiencing grief or isolation, or for reading when I'm experiencing a lot of gratitude, those times when I feel very in love with God and love with Scripture. And that's where we find ourselves in our text today from the prophet Isaiah. All of you who are thirsty, come to the water. Whoever has no money, come, buy food and eat without money at all, no cost, buy wine and milk. Why spend money for what isn't food and your earnings for what doesn't satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good. Enjoy the richest feast. Listen and come to me. Listen and you will live. We start here with this invitation to incline our ear towards God's voice and to seek the fullness in the Word of God. Is that what we're really doing, though? Are we reading the Bible for what all it's worth, if at all? But what Isaiah is teaching us in this text about restoration, about a covenant that is new yet connects to the old, is that the Word of God has and continues to have a mysterious power to inspire us, even amidst the messiness that we've been talking about over the past couple of weeks. We just need to read it. Isaiah says, "Seek the Lord when he can still be found. Call him while he is yet near." The Bible brings us near to the Lord, seeking the Lord in our study. But how can we not get overwhelmed by the long and difficult parts of the Bible that can often make us stop trying to read it? How can we make reading Scripture impactful and fruitful, not just, all right, finished Isaiah, on to the next one, right? Because let me tell you what the best way to stop reading your Bible is, and that's trying to read it cover to cover. And listen, people have done it. I'm super impressed if you've done it. If you've gone Genesis to Revelation, a lot of power to you. But most people, myself included, have tried to do it, and you get through Genesis, feeling good, get through Exodus, and you're feeling good, and then you get to Leviticus, and the momentum starts to die off, right? I've read the whole Bible, but not Genesis to Revelation. There's plenty of other ways that we can read Scripture that I think might actually have a more lasting impact. And the first, it doesn't cover ground quickly, but my first piece of advice as we close up the series is being willing to hang out with a text for a long time. Maybe say this month, I'm just going to look at Genesis. Maybe say this month, I'm just going to look at Genesis chapter 1. Trust me, there's enough material in there to do it. In fact, some of you may have noticed a change in our approach to our kids' church, our Sunday school, that happens. We made a big change in our programming last year, and that's that the students only cover one story a month, but each week interact with it in a new way. One week it's through crafts, another through games, another through science projects, but always the same text for the whole month. So if you miss a week, it's fine, you'll learn about it next week. If you learn through play more than you learn through drawing, you'll have the chance to do that. And what we found is that the kids are really retaining a lot more of the stories. They can tell you a lot more about each of these stories than we'd ever seen before. Yes, it's only 8 stories a year, but they're really learning those 8 stories. The same principle applies to us. And second, I'd say try to figure out your learning style. Are you an audio learner? Should you listen to scripture? Or a kinesthetic learner and should doodle? That's me, right? Is there usually a TV on in your house? Well, try exploring silence. Is there usually silence? Explore the vast world of study music. Do you have a King James Bible? Try a Common English Bible. And there are so many kinds of Bibles beyond just the translations. There's study Bibles where you spend more time reading footnotes than scripture. There are drawing Bibles with blank space for you to draw what you are feeling and inspired by. There are devotional style Bibles with thoughtful questions at the end of each text. There are Bible dictionaries to help you with unfamiliar words and customs. There are commentaries that are, for those who are pretty comfortable reading scripture, it has all this historical context and all these reflections. I myself, and I believe I've mentioned this before, used to have the hardest time with the Psalms. Just like, okay, I read through it, right? Until I experienced it through Gregorian chant. Did not think that that was going to move me in such an impactful way, but this rhythmic, monophonic style of group chanting, it suddenly spoke to me in new ways. There are people who sing the Psalms. They're originally music, and that speaks to them. Others practice Lectio Divina, which is when you read scripture in this slow, meditative, and you meditate over the words or phrases that stick out each time you read it. This is particularly impactful in a group. And like I was mentioning, with hearing a text anew when we hear the scripture readers, because different voices bring different things to the Bible. They bring new life to the Bible, which brings me to my number one tip on reading your Bible: read it with others. Not to say never read it by yourself, right? We all have to read by ourselves. And I'm only somewhat offering a shameless plug about our women's Bible study. But it really is one of my all-time favorite parts of my week, Thursday mornings, when I get together with a group of women at the church. I hope it's as impactful for them as it is for me. And I hear similar sentiments about the men's Bible study that we have here. Our group uses a devotional book that goes through each week's 4 lectionary texts, which are a global weekly breakdown of scripture that many use for preaching and studying. And it doesn't cover the whole Bible, but it covers a large amount. And the devotionals each week have commentary from different voices and different denominations. And the study does look at the historical places and the understanding of the context, but we follow more of a devotional style of reading the Bible. What I mean by that is that we have questions that initiate discussion, typically on how the text relates to us personally. Who do we identify when we read this text? Who do we want to identify with, but we're not? What do we learn about God? In what ways does the story relate to us in the modern world? What kind of text is it? How does that inform our reading? What is the message of the text? What is hard to hear in the text? What comes before and after the text? What other scriptures does it make us think of? And if one thing were different, does the message completely change? And I think what makes this group work so well is the consistency and the relationships built so that there's this trust to ask big questions, self-awareness and vulnerability and open-mindedness to those who I sit down with in this group. It's just so enriching. I always walk away with new perspectives or a new question or a new closeness to others and to God. People teach us about God and God's word. In Isaiah's text, it says, Just as the rain and the snow come down from the sky and don't return without watering the earth, making it conceive and yield plants, and providing seed to the sower and food to the eater, so is my word that comes from my mouth. It does not return to me empty. Instead, it does what I want and accomplishes what I intend. So we take everything that we've looked at in this series, what the Bible is, how to ask or maybe even resolve a few of the big questions, and how we read it for the, everything that can be. May we not return God's word empty and instead allow God to accomplish what God's going to accomplish and move our hearts and our minds in ways that it didn't even just yesterday, if we'd only let it. Let us pray. Holy God, your word overwhelms us. Your word inspires us. Your word makes us pause. Invite us to hear you in new and exciting ways this day so that we may share your message with others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Friends, your generosity helps us to help people in very concrete ways. So 2 weeks ago, we were able to help someone to be able to find a safe place to sleep for the night. This week, we were able to help someone with a cell phone bill who needed some assistance with that. When people hurt, the church's job is to try and help. And so today, you can help people who are affected by Hurricane Ian by making a gift to UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief, through the church. And know that whenever you give to UMCOR, that 100% of your gift goes to help those in need. So if you'd like to contribute, you can drop a check in the basket here in the room, and you can label it UMCOR, Ian. And you also, as an alternative, you could go to our app. You could go to our website at medfordumc.org/give. But however you give, we thank you for your support. And we thank you for your generosity, which enables us to help others in Jesus' name. We're going to take some time now to offer our prayers. And so as we do that, we're going to begin with just a moment of silence. And then I'll invite you into a time of praying with me. But we'll also leave some space so that if there are individual prayers that you would like to lift up, that you have the opportunity to do that. If you're online with us today, we encourage you to lift up your prayers there as well. If you're praying for individuals, please just use first names. Let's pray together. Holy God, on this day, we thank you for the gift of the scriptures. We have spent the last few weeks thinking about how they work in our lives. We've spent today learning about different ways that we can use them to learn more about you, different ways to open our own hearts so that you might speak to us through them. Even as our children today are hearing and learning Bible stories and thinking about how your goodness and your love are active in their lives, we pray that you might do the same for us. As we go through this week, we pray that you might encourage us to pick up our Bibles, to pick up our devotions, to continue to learn and to study. Know that your word will not return to you empty, but that when we open ourselves to the message that you have for us, that you work in our hearts, that you work in our minds, that you work in our lives, so that we might carry your hope out into the world. And we just pray that we might be faithful in that this week. God, we certainly want to celebrate today the joys that you have poured into our lives. We thank you for friends and for family. We thank you for the gift of this season, for opportunities to get together in community, for time that we spend with people that we care about. God, we thank you for the change in season and what it means for us in terms of new recipes that we're making. And just moments of celebration around tables. We thank you, too, just for the change of colors and the beauty that you bring into our eyes, into our hearts. We thank you for all your good gifts to us. But as we gather, we know, too, that there are people that we're lifting up in prayer because we're concerned for them, because they're hurting, and because they need your help. And so today we lift up our prayers for people who are dealing with cancer, for those who are recovering from surgery, for those who are in economic difficulty, who maybe can't make their rent payment this month. We pray for people who don't know how to pay their medical bills. We pray for those who are addicted and those who are wrestling with mental illness.
God, we pray that you would surround all those that we hold dear with your light and with your love. And we lift up the names of those we're particularly concerned for today before you now. God, we lift up these names. We lift up the names of those who have been prayed for online. And we lift up our prayers for this world, knowing that we need your peace to descend upon us, especially in places like Ukraine, but in so many places around the world where people are afraid, where there's strife, where there is uncertainty about the future. We pray that you might surround leaders with your wisdom, that you might surround them with your restraint, that you might lead them in paths of hope and righteousness, that you might help them to properly watch over the people that are charged to their care. God, we thank you that you have given us this church, that you have given us the faith to be able to continue to carry out the mission that you've given us in the world. So we pray as you send us forth, that you send us forth in your love and with your hope. We pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I now invite you to lift your voice with us as we sing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Please stand as you're able.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, I'm leaning on the everlasting.
Invite everyone that we have our coffee time right after service right there in the lobby. There's coffee, there's snacks, and I want to challenge everyone today as a form of discipleship and community building to say hi to someone new, introduce yourselves, and tell them about what you love about Medford UMC. With that, try a small, manageable goal. Try one new way to experience God's word today so that God, God's voice, God's message can be bigger than it was yesterday. Go in peace and go with God. Amen.